الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك على سيدنا محمدٍ في الأولين، اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك على سيدنا محمدٍ في الآخرين، اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك على سيدنا محمدٍ في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. A very sensitive subject, very serious, and alhamdulillah that I am to address it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts, cleanse it. The Quran and the Sunnah indicates that there are two diseases which can contact that very sensitive limb you have in your chest. The first type is fitnatu shubuhat, that your heart possesses a misconception regarding the religion, misunderstanding regarding the religion. The second type, that your heart contacts a fitna pertaining to the whims and the desires. It's called the shahawat. That your heart becomes connected with a certain whim. And this subject of tonight falls into the second category. Brothers and sisters in Islam, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The Quran and the Sunnah, they do two things. Number one, they immune you, they protect you. If you follow it carefully, thoroughly, you can receive the immunity and the protection you need not to fall into any of those two fitness. And this is the rahmah. But what if you have fallen into them? Shifa. There is a cure in the Quran and the Sunnah for those two fitness. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we're talking about a conspiracy here. And this conspiracy is the bornification of society. It's an industry, like pharmaceutical. People are making money off this. They just want more members of the human community, not just the Muslim community, the human community, to be more addicted to this pornography. They actually given it a very interesting title. They called it the P. You know, Egyptians have issues with P and B's. The P bomb, the pornography bomb. Some of you may be aware of a show that we had in the US called the Bay Watcher. Who heard about this show? It's okay. They said we do not have to throw bombs anymore in the Muslim world to occupy them. All what we have to do is throw the bee watcher on them and we will get them. I would love for you to go back tonight and ask Google about the first 10 countries who are number one looking for pornography. 6 of them are Muslims. Number one is a Muslim country, and I'm not going to name them because I don't want to put down anybody. You can go and find out for yourself. The first 6 countries are Muslims. So it's a sad reality. It's there, brothers and sisters in Islam. And not talking about it doesn't help either. We have to talk about it. We have to address it. And not because you're sitting here, you're guilty of it. Allah knows best. It's between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But at least you're here adopting the madhab of one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whose name is Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiyallahu anhu. Hudhayfa in Sahih al-Bukhari says, all the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would ask him about good things. Ya Rasulullah, what if I do this? What good thing do I get? What are the good things which will happen in the future? And I was the one who would normally ask about the bad things, the fitan, in order to protect myself against them. And a lot of you are fathers, a lot of you are mothers, and you need to help your children to protect themselves from this. This is why we are talking about it. We're also addressing it as Muslims because, quite frankly, rational non-Muslims concluded that they should stop that stuff. There is a country called Iceland. Iceland is a very liberal country. But subhanAllah, they adopted something that Saudi Arabia does. Which is what? Banning pornography from their countries, because they learned the devastating impact of this on an individual. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we're talking about addiction. Pornography is addiction, idman. It's not a habit. And go home and just ask Sheikh Google again to give you the difference between a habit, something that you do because it's a habit, or something that you do because it's addiction. What you do because it's addiction controls you. The addiction takes control over you. But a habit, you're still in control. You can change it. And that's the danger of this subject. Go home again and do your research. And I think you should be engaged in this, because it is affecting a lot of people. Pornography, according to the lawyers of the divorce in the United States of America, is becoming reason number one for divorce. Why? Because one of the partners is more interested in watching these artificial, virtual, and I'm sorry to use the word, intercourse, rather than being with his or her husband or spouse. They are no longer interested in this. And the way that science, and it's so amazing when you see science sometimes, it really, validating what you have in the Quran and the Sunnah. You see, the Quran and the Sunnah states that you should not even get near this. وَلَا تَقْرَبُ الزِّنَا. Do not come near it. Avoid it. Because it's dangerous. It will get to you. Look at this, how science explains this. There is some substance in the brain, they call it dopamine. I don't know if this is correct or not. Some of you will. What is dopamine? A substance which really gets you to do stuff. When the brain produces a volume or a quantity of it, this is what gets you excited about doing things. It's like the reward that I get for drinking that water. The feeling that I get, the dopamine, when I see the water, so it triggers. Now they tell you that a person who watches pornography, that substance is produced in a way that no material drug would do. The level of excitement, that virtual world. So what does he do? Then he goes about, and I'm sorry again to use this, he goes about processing that desire. And the danger of pornography, it is associated with what we know by العادة السرية, masturbation, both. It causes, so he needs to process this. He needs to get rid of this. Now, when he goes into the real world with his wife, he's no longer interested. He is more interested in that virtual world which does not exist. He doesn't realize that the people whom he watches, or she watches, by the way, the women are involved in this too. It's virtual world. That video is prepared for you. Those people are acting. These people are artificial. Their beauty is artificial. Their behavior is artificial, is not real. Now when you get in the bedroom with your wife, it's the real thing. It's totally different. That dopamine doesn't come out. You're not interested in your wife. You're more interested in what produces more dopamine into the brain. And this is why the separation happens gradually between you and your spouse. You're no longer interested in her. And we as imams, we receive these phone calls. My husband hasn't slept with me for the last 6 months, Sheikh. He's spending his time in front of the computer. He's married to the computer. And I know what she means by this. So it's, brothers and sisters in Islam, it's a dangerous tool. It's a money making for people. It's like bad drugs. They sell to us. And we become addicted to it. All what they want is the money. They tell you that the pornographic industry brings in trillions of dollars, more than ABC, CBS combined. Imagine this. I read another status, 216, more than the NFL. Money. It's about money. And the more people they recruit into this, and they offer you this for free. And if you go and study and read some of these studies, it used to be in the past that you don't have to pay for that stuff. You have to pay for that stuff in the past. If you read, you would have to pay $10, dollar. They call it subscription, whatever you pay. But they made it for free. Why? Because once you get hooked up on it, you need to produce more dopamine. You see, that video that you used to watch will not be satisfying. You need to go to another level. you need to watch more stuff. It's like somebody who smokes marijuana, for example. The joint is not enough anymore. He has to actually do two joints, three joints, in order to get the same level of being high. And gradually he will find himself going into what? Into cocaine, into harder stuff. The same thing happens with pornography, even though it is not a material substance. It has to do with your behavior. But it's the same exact process. The more you go into it, you find yourself wanting more materials in order to produce that dopamine, or sometimes you get into weird stuff that you did not even expect yourself to watch, to look at. You would consider to be abnormal stuff because you're still looking for that feeling, for that satisfaction, which is not happening through these small little videos which you have. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I really intend today to bring our attention to this. I do not mean to say that every single person is involved in this, but you could be involved in this. And I'm telling you, a lot of people are involved in this. It's a secret world. Yeah, the government knows about it. Imam Ibrahim kind of indicated this. Government mail, Gmail, they know about it. They know all your history, even if you go and delete it. They know it. But regarding your circle, your close circle, nobody knows anything about you. It's between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I don't think the government is going to release any of that stuff unless if you go and, you know, and get in trouble. It's still going to stay a secret between you and the government. But it's a secret world out there. A secret world out there. Look, the story that our brother told us, Imam Ibrahim. Imagine this. I read that story before. And the version of it is heartbreaking. That these brothers who used to receive that porno from the grave, coming to them from the grave, they used to cry. This is our friend. And here we are, we're still receiving this from him. It can get to your lives. It can affect you. Let's talk about the cure for a minute. What is the cure? First of all, you need to realize that this disease is an addiction like any other addiction. It is an addiction. And it's actually a very interesting type of addiction. Addiction to something that is so accessible. Right now, wherever you go, you have access to it. iPhone, smartphone, Samsung, Facebook, every place. On the movies, every place. You can't escape it. Sometimes actually it happens that you would be doing stuff on the internet, regular stuff, and then you find these clips showing on the site. Then you become interested in it. Then it takes you to another clip. Then it takes you to another clip. Then you find yourself there. You can't prevent it. Computers, the cyber world is becoming a part of us. Look at us holding to our phones. You can't escape it. Now, the problem is, if you got hooked on this, you are literally addictive. You're falling into it. And the treatment, brothers and sisters in Islam, number one is to admit this. A lot of people are in a state of denial. No, that's not me. I'm not doing this. No, you're doing it. Even when we talk about sinning in Islam, committing a sin, You know, we always go back and reflect upon the story of Adam and Satan. And we learn a lot of lessons from that story. And one of the most important lessons which we learn is this very point that I'm trying to bring out to you, that you actually confess what you've done wrong, that you're guilty of it. You see, Satan was commanded to prostrate to Adam. He disobeyed Allah and he refused. He turned down the command. Adam was commanded not to eat from the tree. He ate from the tree. The question here, why Satan is cursed, even though both of them have sinned? Both of them committed the sin, the disobedience. But why Adam was given a second chance and Satan not? Because of this, the attitude. Adam said, oh Allah, I made a mistake. I'm weak. We're all weak. We were trapped. We're all trapped into this. Some of us got into this without even knowing. Some of us even did it without even knowing that this is actually addiction. That it can become a disease that extremely difficult to leave. You have to rehab yourself for month and month and train yourself for month and month. Some of us for years and years to come out of it. You didn't know that. But confess that you're doing it. You cannot be in a state of denial. Not because you go to the history and delete history, then you're done. No. You're still guilty of it before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Satan was asked, why didn't you prostrate? مَا مَنَعَكَ أَلَّا تَسْجُدَ إِذْ أَمَرْتُكَ What did he say? أَنَا خَيْرٌ Should he be commanding me to do this? But Adam, أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا عَنْ تِلْكُمَ الشَّجَرَةِ وَأَقُلْ لَكُمَا إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمَا عَدُوٌّ مُبِينٌ What did they say, Adam and Eve? قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا Ya Rab, we did it. We're weak. We made a mistake. Because I'm telling you something. The only one who can protect you from this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're going to talk about means, which you can take. But the only one who can take you out of this is Allah. You cannot do it in your own. And this is step number two. After you confess, regret what you have done wrong, you beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a dua, to take you out of this. Because you're sick of it. And the only one who can cures is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ And this is why you need to step up out there and say, Ya Rab, help me out. Take me out of this. Now, beside these three steps, you confess it, you regret it, and you make dua. Now it's time to act upon it. Find out what triggers this. When do you have the tendency to do this stuff? That's step important because this is a very individual thing. It varies from one person to another, by the way. Some of us, when they face a problem, they actually run away to this. Like when you have a problem with your life, with your marriage, with your spouse, and then you just run away to the computer. The person would run away to the computer. Some of us, oh, I have time on my hand. I just wanna do it, you know? Some people actually, and this is a very interesting piece, especially with the devoted Muslims, and you would be surprised to hear devoted Muslims doing this. Actually, some of them justify it this way. I'm not going to commit adultery. That's how they actually get themselves into doing this. There is no way I'm going to commit adultery. And this is the least of the two evils. So let me just watch that and do. So for him, he doesn't want to commit adultery. Now, the way to avoid committing adultery is to do this. So every one of us develop a psychology that triggers the want, the desire, which later on, after being addicted, it becomes a must. You must get it. You need it. It's no longer a desire. So you need to analyze yourself. Why am? When do I do this? When do I do this? Now, try to find alternative for this. Say, okay, when I become upset, you know what? I'm going to do this instead of this. But you have to figure out when, because I want to stress this, this varies from one person to another. Now, what else you can do is do not access the internet alone. You will find the people who are into this, they spend hours and hours in front of the computer and they do this in private. No, get a big screen in the living room somewhere with, you know, huge resolutions. So everybody would be watching what you're doing. Put it in the kitchen. Put it in the living room. Stay away from laptops. If you have a way to prevent this stuff, filter this stuff in your home with your internet service, do this, especially for your own kids. Do this. But try to get supervision from the people around you. This is extremely important. Add to this, brothers and sisters in Islam, the most important of them all. Like we spoke at the very beginning of my talk about the two diseases, the misconceptions, the shubuhat, and the whims and desires, al-shahawat. Al-ilm takes care of the first one, knowledge. If you want to cure the first disease which contact this heart, is through knowledge that you learn the deen, through the reliable sources, reliable people. But if you want to take care of the second fitna, al-iman. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ وَالْإِيمَانِ Iman. You need iman. You need beliefs. You need to increase your iman. And iman increases through the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the most important pillars of this deen that can help you certainly take care of this matter is a salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Inna salata wa aqim salata, inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. Establish the salah. Indeed, the salah will help you stop al-fahsha, will help you stop al-munkar. But some of the brothers and the sisters normally will say, Ya Sheikh, I pray and I'm still doing it. Aqim al-salah. Pray salatul nabi. Not your salah. Not Allahu Akbar, Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, Sami'a Allah. No, pray the salah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aqim al-salah. The way it should be performed, body and soul, the presence of the heart, it will help you. قرأت حديث يا إخوة أن رجلا, a man during the day used to commit sins, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was told that at night he prays the Tahajjud. Imagine this. Look at the contradiction here. Tahajjud. You know what? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, salatuhu billayl. His salah at night will help him stop his sin one day. Mahwa, listen. When we say addiction, We're talking about the harga tainted. The best parable I'd like to give, you know, a sponge, you know, the sphinx, you know, the sponge, right? When you put a pen on the top of that sponge and you keep it for a while, what happens to the ink? The ink goes away, penetrates. Exactly, your heart becomes like this with an addiction. That your heart sucked this fitna. Your heart like a sponge, sucked that ink. Now for you to take that ink out, you think it's sufficient to wash that sponge one time? How many times you have to wash that sponge? How many times? Multiple times. Maybe 10 times. Maybe 20 times. Maybe 30 times. To remove this ink completely out of the sponge, because it's down there, down deep. And you know what? I'm telling you, sometimes it will take a trial and fail. Fail and a trial. Fail and try. A lot of the brothers, they go, Sheikh, I do it, and then I repent for a week, and then I come back to it. I repent for a month, then I come back to it. Some of them for 6 months, I come back. Keep trying. Keep washing the sponge. Maho, listen, you would rather receive the angel of death trying when you're trying to stop this, then you submitted. You said, I'm not going to leave it. I'm going to die with this. Which is better? You know, maybe the angel of death will come and find you in a state when you are actually clean from this. So you have to keep trying with the salah, the hajjud at night, a dua. This young man, when he approached Hadith Abi Umama fi Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, when he approached the gathering, the Prophet and his companions, and what did he say? Ya Rasul Allah, O Messenger of Allah, إِذَنْ لِي بِالزِّنَا. Can you give me a permission to commit adultery? Imagine this. He's asking the Prophet ﷺ's permission to commit adultery. Of course, the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ looked at him and they are about to beat him up. No, leave him alone. And he said to this young man, Udnu, come closer. And he asked him a series of questions. أَتَرْضَ هَذَا لِأُمِّكِ. Would you like someone to do this to your mother? He said, no. He said, well, الناس. People do not like someone to do this to their mothers. Why would you do this? أَتَرْضَ هَذَا لِأُخْتِكِ. What about your sister? Would you like somebody to do this to your sister? What about your aunt? What about your aunt? He said, no. And then at the end, the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم made dua for this young man. اللَّهُمَّ طَهِّرْ قَلْبَهُ وحصل فرجة وفي ثالثة. Oh Allah, purify his heart, make him chaste, make him guard his private parts. This man, because of دعوة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, left the whole thing. He said, this fitna of women became irrelevant to me. I'm no longer interested. فالدعاء. So you have to keep up with this, brothers and sisters in Islam. The brothers wanted to allow question and answer, and I will do this. But I want to say something at the end. Brothers, not because someone is involved in this, he should be outcast. He should be by us. He should be outcast. Or he should be like looked down upon. That's the point I'm trying to make. No. You know what? A lot of good people are involved in this. They are good people. But they are involved in this. They just got hooked up on it. And I have an evidence from the Sunnah. Hadith Umar ibn al-Khattab, a man whose name is Abdullah ibn Himar, that's his name. Every time they bring him to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in order to establish had shurb al-khamr, the criminal punishment in Islam for drinking alcohol. He drinks, he gets drunk, and every time he's brought to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to establish the had on him. But one of the people, while they were establishing the had on him, said, Allahumma al-ana. Oh Allah, curse him. He often being brought to this. He's brought over and over again. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about this man who's alcoholic. He's addict to alcohol. Don't do this. He loves Allah and His Messenger. Listen, like I said a minute ago, this is a disease. This is an addiction. This is an addiction. Another point to make, and alhamdulillah, I'm so impressed by the youth being present in this. Some of the youth, they say to themselves, because really the range of the age, according to the study that I came across, 13 to 17, those are the most curious people. Over 90% of 13 to 17 expose themselves to this. 60 once it comes to females. So what they do? They want to learn. And a lot of the Muslim brothers at this age group, they say what? Oh, I'm just going to do this until I get married, and after I get married, I will leave this. No. If you fall into this, you become addicted to this, and you will do it after marriage. That phenomenon out there that marriage will cure this is wrong. Because again, of the process of the brain, the dopamine, the natural, regular thing doesn't excite you anymore. What causes the production of that dopamine is the abnormal virtual that you watch online. So this is a misconception, number one. Another misconception, brothers and sisters in Islam, a lot of the brothers, they justify this by saying, well, I want to learn how to do it. So they actually look at this material to be what? Kind of educational in how to have a relationship with one spouse. I want to learn more stuff. You need to understand that your wife or your spouse are not that type that you watch. You see, you hardly see kissing. You see romance in these videos. You see machines, people acting up. It's not, and this is what you want to do in the bedroom with your wife? That's not the reality. That's not the right thing. No. And a lot of times we find actually brothers expecting their wives or their spouses to do things that they watch, which is abnormal, and sometimes it's actually haram to do. I try to combine everything in those 45 minutes, allow 15 minutes for question and answer. But like I said, brothers and sisters in Islam, it's a matter that you cannot ignore. It's a problem in our homes, in our societies, that we should not ignore. We should talk about it. We should address it. This is important. Ignoring it is not going to help you. It's not going to help the Ummah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect our youth and our children.
Ameen.
We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts.
Ameen.
We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fill our hearts with iman and faith so that we overcome such fitan ya rabbal alameen. Inshallah, jazakallahu khairan.